Lecture 16, I Like Ike. So I'm having to redo this one because it went crazy into technology. So, hey, I'm getting better at these, I think, as far as what makes it work. But anyway, I Like Ike, 1953 to 1961. However, I'm actually going to move back a little bit farther. On that last one about post-war adjustment, the outline has the 1952 election in it. And I decided to move it to the beginning of this lecture because it just flows, I think, better that way. So, Ike, of course, is Dwight David Eisenhower. Okay, we met him before. He was commanding Operation Overlord, the invasion of France during World War II. In fact, he was in North Africa and Italy and then commanded the Normandy invasion. Okay. So, he is very closely associated with the 50s. When people think of the 1950s, you know, Eisenhower just kind of goes with it because his administration spanned 8 of the 10 years. Some things about the 50s real quick, because I really don't have a lecture on the 50s as a social history, because I don't really do the social history. Not that I would love to, but there's only so many hours of the day. But the 50s are a very fascinating time. There's a lot going on, and in retrospect, a lot of people say, oh, the 50s were boring. That's just hogwash. There's lots going on in the 50s. But I think one thing that hurts the 50s when people look at it is, of course, in the 30s, we had the Depression. In the 40s, we had World War II. In the 60s, we'll have, you know, Vietnam and the Civil Rights Movement and the hippies. And so the 50s seem kind of dull in comparison because they've got these two high-happening decades on either side. But in reality, a lot was going on. Okay? And a lot of it, like I said, falls into the social history category. Pop culture, television, and rock and roll, and things like that. I'd love to spend some time on this, but I just don't have the time. However, we do have a reading textbook reading quiz. The third textbook reading quiz goes with a chapter that goes with the 50s. And I'll put this up on Canvas here, you know, soon. Okay. Now, one reason I did that was the End of Course Study Guide has a lot of stuff about the 50s in it. But, of course, we don't have to do the End of Course test now, so you're getting out of that. But it's still, I've already designed the class around that, and I don't want to have to try to reinvent it and come up with an alternative assignment. So we'll still have the 1950s social history textbook quiz coming up shortly. Okay. But let's move into Eisenhower. So, 1952, Truman will step down. Now, Truman could have run again. After Franklin Roosevelt was elected 4 times, they do pass a constitutional amendment that limits the president to being elected for 2 terms. Now, if a vice president gets promoted to president due to the death of the president, and he serves less than half a term, they won't count that against that president's 2 elections. Okay? So, in theory, you could be president up to 10 years, but it would take a very specific set of circumstances to make that happen. But you could only be elected twice. Okay. Now, Truman was exempt from this. He could have run again, but he doesn't. He, you know, goes ahead and counts it as 2 terms because basically he served all of Roosevelt's 4th term other than the first 3 months. Okay. So, 1952 is going to be a wide open contest. Okay. All right. The Democrats will end up nominating a guy named Adlai Stevenson, shown here on the left. Now, Adlai Stevenson is most famous for his diplomatic work. Now, his dad, if I recall, was vice president for Grover Cleveland, one of Grover Cleveland's 2 terms. So Stevenson has served, you know, his family has served, you know, the United States in various capacities. Okay? But when I think of him, I usually think of some diplomatic stuff that happens later. Okay? All right. And I don't know who was running against Stevenson for the Democratic ticket, but he is one against the nod. Now, Republican side, a little more complicated. All right? Remember, they've been out of power now since 1932. They'd really like to get back into the White House. And various people were running for the opportunity to run for the Republicans. One was Senator Robert Taft, who was definitely on the more conservative side of the Republican Party. Okay? What's going to happen is when they get to the 1952 Republican Convention, none of the candidates have enough balance to win the nomination outright, okay, on the first ballot. Okay? So they have to do some people that have to do some negotiating, some trading, some reconsidering. Now, Dwight Eisenhower had run in the primary, and he'd won delegates, but he wasn't the leader going into the convention. Okay? But he emerges as a compromise candidate. He's someone that, you know, the conservatives, you know, maybe in the party could live with. Liberals in the party, you know, probably like him. And so he's one of these, he's kind of like James K. Polk in that respect. He's not necessarily everyone's first choice, but he's enough people's second choice that he'll end up getting the nod. Okay? Now, Dwight Eisenhower running for president. Basically, no political experience, hasn't been elected to anything, so what do you think he's running on? I'm Dwight David Eisenhower, and I'm a, say it out loud, war hero. Ah. In fact, one of the things they talk about is, remember, the Korean War is still going on at this time, and Eisenhower is, you know, saying, you know, who better to try to wrap the war up than a president who's been a general? So, you know, Eisenhower is another one of these war heroes elected president, but I'm going to argue that he's a little bit different than, say, an Andrew Jackson or Ulysses S. Grant, that Eisenhower's experience maybe does give him some qualifications to be president. How so, you ask? Well, Eisenhower's not one of these big tactical generals. He's not one of these guys out in the field, you know, like George S. Patton or someone, you know, driving tanks or planning attacks. He's more of a manager-type general. Okay, now, this is not meant to disparage his qualifications. Okay? Think about it. Eisenhower has commanded a multinational force in the Mediterranean. Going into North Africa, okay, he had to deal with, you know, the British and the Americans. All right? And as we land, we have to, you know, find a way to cooperate with the French who control that part of North Africa. Later, when the army goes into Italy, it's an even more multinational force. There's British, there's Americans, you know, there's Free French, there's Polish troops. I think some New Zealanders were there, if I recall, maybe some Canadians. It was a very much a multinational force operating in the Mediterranean. And then, of course, later he goes to England to command Operation Overlord. Now, think about this. Okay? He's commanding a joint venture. Okay. The majority of the troops are Americans, but there's substantial contributions from the British. Okay, he has to manage and weigh all the contradictory needs of these different people. I mean, he has to coordinate actions of the Army, the Navy, the U.S. Army Air Force, the Royal Air Force, the Royal Navy, the Royal Army. Okay, so he's got this multinational group of commanders from various countries, and they have different ways of looking at things. The Navy's priorities aren't necessarily the same as the Army's priorities. Okay? He also has the political aspect. He's got Winston Churchill, you know, there in England offering helpful advice, peering over his shoulder. Now, you know, Franklin Roosevelt's at home in Washington, D.C., so he can't, you know, interfere with Eisenhower as much. So, and then the Operation Overlord plan is so complex that it's really, you know, a lot of it's been laid out prior to Eisenhower getting there. So really he's doing is like a managerial role. He has to, you know, massage egos and keep people all, it's like herding cats. He's got to deal with prima donnas like George S. Patton and Bernard Montgomery, the British general. Yeah. So Eisenhower's learned how to juggle a lot of balls at the same time. He's, you know, learned to try to mold a disparate group of people into some kind of team. And so I could argue that as qualifications for president goes, they're not totally insane. You know, this is the kind of experience that could make you an effective president, even if you have not a lot of, you know, actual political type experience. He has a lot of managing experience. And the president is, after all, the chief executive. Okay? So it's Eisenhower versus Stevenson. Nowadays, this contest could not happen because both men are bald and we now have television and everybody's hung up on how people look. But in 52, not everybody has television and they offset because they cancel each other out because they're both bald. Eisenhower will name for his running mate, I think he's on the next slide. Yeah, Richard M. Nixon, who we met in the Alger Hiss case. He was dealing with HUAC, the House Un-American Activities Committee. He's one of the people who went after Alger Hiss and has kind of raised his visibility in the Republican Party. Okay? So he was in the House of Representatives. He then went into the Senate for a little while before Eisenhower picked Nixon to be his running mate in 1952. Okay? I think there's a button here. Let's see. I can Dick. Sure to click, it says here. Or some button said, I like Ike. Well, who doesn't like Ike? He seems like everybody's grandfather, right? So, when the election results come in, here's what we get. This should be the next slide. Here we go. Eisenhower's in blue, okay? 55% of the popular vote, it looks here. About 83% of the electoral vote. Stevenson's in red. Stevenson really can only carry the solid South. And he doesn't even carry all of that. Look, Texas goes to Eisenhower. Now, Eisenhower had been born in Texas, up in Denison, if I recall, but he'd actually grown up in Kansas. So he had a connection to Texas, but it was kind of loose. But look, he won Florida, too, and Tennessee. So Eisenhower's popular enough that he chips into the solid South, okay? And ends up getting elected to be president with a substantial, like a 10-point swing there. Okay? And so, like I said, Eisenhower is always closely associated with the 50s. Okay? I think that's all I have here. I'm having to go back and redo this one, but I have where the next one starts. So I think we should be good. This will get us started, and then we'll call it. Stop this one, and you can go on to video number 2.